Thank you. Good afternoon. I hope you've had some great speakers, and I'm honored to have an opportunity to address you today. My name is Christopher Gaston. I run an immigration law firm in Stewart. I've been doing that for about 5 or 6 years now after I've left government service. My opportunity today is to talk with you about immigration and inclusion. When I first got the chance and the information about the program, I was excited. Immigration and inclusion, there's just so much to talk about with that issue. I work with immigrants as they're first coming to the United States, and the challenges for inclusion with immigration and with immigrants is just incredibly vast. We think of maybe a person coming from all the way around the world. Their language is different, their culture is different, their norms are different, their behaviors are different, and they're coming to the United States with their family to try to make a life and fit into our society. But the obstacles that they face are when they interact with society, sometimes because they don't know the norms and the practices and the culture, things are different and maybe their actions sort of repel people. I was talking to a gentleman earlier, and I was telling him about a trip I took to China, and I mentioned that the way people interact in the stores and in businesses are different. You'll stand in line and somebody will stand very closely behind you, and you'll step up and they'll step up and you look back and all right, and you step up and they step up and you feel like now you've started a relationship. So, but that's the culture, and you know, that's a challenge that they have to overcome when they come here, because when that happens here, people are, this is my personal space, this is my bubble. So that's a challenge. So what happens with that situation is a negative experience occurs because someone has said, well, you're in my personal space, I need you to move. Now, in the society, they feel that there's a perception that they're violating the norms, and they kind of are less interested or less, they take a smaller step towards trying to integrate in society because they don't understand and they just want to make sure they're not offending people. People are noticing, well, you look different and you talk different and you behave different, and I'm not sure if I like all of your differences, so maybe I'm going to keep you at arm's length. And those are the kinds of barriers to inclusion that we face when we talk about immigration and immigrants and inclusion. So in thinking about this kind of in an overarching view, I found that there's maybe three categories in my work. Three barriers that are existing in this area of immigration and immigrants and inclusion. The first barrier is one that a lot of us, if we are not immigrants or we haven't worked with immigrants, we don't deal with regularly, and that's the legal barrier. The right to be here in a lawful status and be present and be accepted in society, the desire to not be in a situation where you have to hide or conceal your immigration status, but you can stand up and be ready to be a member of society. So that's the first barrier, and that's where I help my clients with obtaining the lawful status so that they have the confidence to be able to seek to be included in our society. So that's the first one. The next one I would mention is the societal barrier. Now that's the one that is associated with the example I was talking about, where the norms and the activities of the religion, the language, all of those things create a barrier with interacting in society and other people in society, in the community, in the neighborhoods, maybe aren't accepting of the immigrants and their differences, and we have this barrier to inclusion, which in my mind leads to the third one, which is which persists long after the other two may have been overcome, and that's the self-segregation. We see that a lot with immigrant communities where the new immigrant wants to go into a community where he or she knows the culture, they know the language, they know the mores, they know the norms, and they don't want to venture out of that community, even if they have lawful status, even if the other areas of society are willing to help them with or accept them as they are. They've had some experience that causes them now to say, look, I'm just going to stay here where it's safe and where I know what's going on, and I'm okay with the way things work, and I know that I'm not going to be treated as I'm a different person. So those are the three barriers that I see: the legal, the social, and the self-segregating. But I think the real issue is there's a threshold question here. Is something we want to have in our society, in our communities, in our neighborhood, a inclusion with immigrants? Is that something that we want? It's a political season, and we've heard that there are a lot of different opinions on how immigrants should be treated in our society and what position they should hold. And that's one of the threshold questions to deciding whether we're even going to pursue this inclusion of immigrants. So, of course, I've worked with a lot of immigrants, and my experience has been incredibly positive. One of the statistics that I've come across, and I share this with everybody I can, is it's the average is about 2% of the people in the world that leave everything that they know, the land they know, their families, everything that they've grown up with, and move to another country and learn another culture. And I find those people to be incredibly brave, and they're strong, and they're driven, and they enhance our country and enhance our culture. I think of a couple of examples that I believe are very strong. The former CEO and founder of Apple has created a company that has changed the way we see personal communication, the way we listen to music, the way we obtain our information. Every year when the new Apple iPhone comes out, it breaks barriers and it changes the way we think about how electronic devices and personal devices can do for us. When I was a kid, the phone was the block on the wall with the cord, and it rang, and if you had a really advanced phone system, you could do the click over and talk to another person or maybe conference someone in. Now you can have a video chat with somebody on a beach on the other side of the world. This Steve Jobs, the founder, came to America as the son of Syrian refugees, I'm sorry. And without a program that allows an individual like Steve Jobs to come to the United States, we don't have the innovation, because this is the country where that type of innovation can flourish. Another example is Elon Musk. He's from South Africa. And he came to the United States as an immigrant. He was initially rejected. He came because of he applied for an immigrant visa based on his extraordinary ability in business and was rejected. And you think about it, so Elon Musk was rejected. He's the founder of BankX, the first online bank, the predecessor of PayPal. He's the founder of Tesla Corporation, the leader in electronic vehicles. The founder of SpaceX, a company that has a $1.5 billion contract to supply the International Space Station, and he's able to do it with recyclable rockets. And he's purchasing Solar City. And we think if a gentleman like Elon Musk has trouble getting here and being accepted legally to come to the United States, what are the challenges that a tradesman or an agricultural worker faces when they're trying to come to the United States? So I know when I give these examples, people say, "Well, Chris, it's Elon Musk, it's Steve Jobs. What are the challenges he's facing?" I mean, you know, these are incredible people. They've gotten vast resources and they've contributed so much to our society. So it is important to say, when we're asking the question, do we want to include immigrants in our society? We take a look at all immigrants and we look at people from all walks of life. And there's some examples I want to talk about. And I'd like to use somebody I'm going to call Rosalinda. Rosalinda is a young Hispanic woman. She's undocumented. She came to the United States. She works cleaning houses, trying to support her two children. Because she's undocumented, one of her greatest fears is contact with law enforcement. She doesn't want to be in a situation where she's going to get deported or her children will be deported back to a place where the conditions are desperate. Her employer knows this, and for that reason, he feels it's okay for him to mistreat her and abuse her because she's not going to go to law enforcement and report this. One of the questions we ask is, do we want our society, a society that says, Rosalinda is paying her penance because she's here, she hasn't come to the United States in a lawful manner, and she gets what she gets for not following the law? Or do you want to encourage somebody like Rosalinda to come forward and say, look, I'm still a human being, I'm still a person, regardless of my immigration status or where I come from, I need to be treated like a person and report any mistreatment to the proper authorities. Now, there are people who have been on both sides of this issue, and when I ask this question, people have those types of opinions. I'm not going to turn it over now, but just ask you to think about it. And we'll take the scenario to the next stage. Now, Rosalina is still working and she's still cleaning the houses, but instead of her being abused, she witnesses her employer being abusive to his children. And Rosalina is the only one that sees this. And unlike the situation where she's the victim of a crime and she reports it, there's not an immigration benefit. If she were the victim, she reported a crime, there would be, the immigration law gives us a little guidance and says they're gonna provide a way for her to stay in the United States to be able to have justice and have the offender prosecuted. But that's not available in all situations when you're reporting somebody else a crime that you've witnessed. So again, it's a question about our society and what we think about immigration and inclusion. Do we want a non-citizen, somebody who's here, maybe in an unlawful status, to feel like they're enough a part of the society to step forward, even if that means someone will know that they're here undocumented and know that our law enforcement, our authorities are going to make sure that the crime is addressed and not use that opportunity of her stepping forward to exploit the fact that she's undocumented and have her removed from the United States. Again, I'm not going to ask for any responses for that, but that's something I'd like to think about and as we transition to our final scenario. Our final scenario, we're going to leave Rosalinda and we're going to talk about Khalil. Khalil is a student. He's here in the United States. His student visa has expired. He's still studying. He's working as a night auditor at a motel. His family's here as well. He's undocumented. And while he's here, he notices that there's some strange individuals that have been staying at the hotel for a couple of days. They keep to themselves. They speak in their own language, but Khalil and his family share the same homeland as these individuals, and he knows that the statements they're making are anti-American sentiments. As he continues to do his job, he takes towels to the room and notices some anti-American propaganda, weapons, things that he thinks are used to make firecrackers or whatever, but he knows that these gentlemen are planning to do something that he believes is illegal. His parents have told him to stay away from them and to stay out of it. he has had trouble before because of where he's from and his language and his religion. He's not been accepted by society in America. And he has some real concerns that if he voices his concerns about the men staying in the hotel, he'll be associated with them and he'll suffer some of the same investigation and consequences that they suffer. In this scenario, do we want Khalil to feel like he's part of our society enough to go forward and take the risk to do the things that are necessary, to report the offense and have the investigation, the warrants, and everything that's necessary to prevent something tragic from happening? The point of scenarios, the point of the stories about Elon Musk and Steve Jobs is this. Regardless of how we feel personally about immigrants, it's undeniable that having immigrants in our community has been great for our business, been great for our economy, has been great for making America better and safer. The arguments about how we will handle the immigration matter are on both sides. What I'd like to talk about before we go, what I'd like to talk about is something that I do a little bit more of and I spend a lot of time doing, is the legal inclusion part of the immigration laws and why that is such a huge challenge for immigrants coming to the United States or those who are already here. One of the things I hear all the time is everybody, that immigrants would be accepted if they just would do things the right way. They would just follow the law and do everything the way it's supposed to be done. And whenever I hear somebody say that, I want to remind them about our immigration laws. The Immigration and Nationality Act that is currently the basis of our immigration laws was drafted in the 1950s, at a time when our population was different, the world's population was different, our needs were different, our immigration goals were different, our concerns were different. It's been unanimously agreed that our immigration laws need to be updated, reformed, whatever anybody wants to call it. But we do understand that this needs to happen. And the challenge is, it makes doing everything the right way extremely difficult. To many of the people who immigrate to the United States want to eventually become U.S. citizens. To be a U.S. citizen, you have to either be born in the United States, be born from U.S. citizen parents, or go through a process called naturalization. It's the application process where you demonstrate that you have a basic knowledge of English, U.S. history, U.S. civics, and that you are a person of good moral character, pay your taxes, do the things you're supposed to do. But to be able to do that, you have to become a lawful permanent resident, which means you have to fit into one of four categories. Permanent residents are either have to receive an immigrant petition from a family member, an employer. There's a humanitarian basis for individuals who are seeking asylum if they've been persecuted in their home country. And lastly, believe it or not, there's the lottery system. It's called the diversity lottery. It's primarily made up of countries that are European, and they're eligible to pay the money, file the forms, and if their case is picked, their case is reviewed and they can receive permanent residency. For most of my clients and most of the people that I deal with, the last two options are not really viable. Playing the lottery, well, we've all played the lottery, so we know how likely it is that you'll win. And the asylum cases, generally, that's most people don't have those that type of basis for coming to the United States. While it is a viable source, it's just not everybody's basis. If for the regular person who wants to come to the United States to be with their family or to work, their options are the family-based immigration or the employment-based immigration. Family-based immigration means U.S. citizens or permanent residents can ask for certain family members to come to the United States. If you're a U.S. citizen, you can petition for your children, your spouse, your parents and your siblings, if they're your siblings. And that's it. No grandparents, no uncles, no aunts, no nieces, nephews, cousins. No matter how close that relationship is, how strong the bond, immigration doesn't recognize it. So when my clients say my grandmother's age, you know, I want to bring her here and have her with the family, meet the grandchildren, the answer is no. Now, for the immigration categories that that are available, parents, children, siblings, spouses, the immigration laws have a quota and a number of visas that are available every year. So if you were to apply for a visa for your adult child as a U.S. citizen, guess what? He or she's not showing up for 8 years. That visa's not going to show up for 8 years. If you're lucky, if you happen to be from a country like India, if your child happens to live in India or China or Mexico or the Philippines, your child may not be eligible to receive a visa for 26 years. When you say, let's do it the right way, and immigrants should do everything the right way and get in the back of the line, that line is 26 years long. Does anybody in the room want to wait 26 years to see their child again? It doesn't make any sense. That's not the intent of the immigration laws, but remember, they were drafted in 1952 when our populations were different and the demand was different. So that's the family-based immigration. Let's say you were coming here because you had a job. Well, unskilled labor, skilled labor, the employers have the same system that we were talking about, the same system where there's quotas and caps. So an employer who wants, so every year, the number of employers who need to hire skilled and unskilled labor is double or triple the number of visas that are available. So you're running a business, you need you need trim carpenters, finished carpenters, and there aren't any in your area, so you want to hire someone who is one, but he's a non-citizen. You pay the money, you have a lottery, and if your case is selected and if it's approved, then you have your employee. If not, you have to figure out a way to run the business without the employee. It's a challenging system, but this is what we are facing when we say immigrants should do things the right way. And the challenge of being able to get into a lawful status and be in the United States legally, in my mind and in my experience, has been the catalyst to the other two barriers to inclusion. When individuals are not in a legal status, they're less likely to want to step forward and be involved in society because their view of and what they've heard about how society will treat them as a undocumented person or a person who doesn't have a permanent status in the United States. So it leads to the self-segregation and seclusion that, again, is a huge enemy to inclusion in the United States. So I guess the question is, what's the solution? How do we handle it? How would we fix it? If we are going to adopt the premise and assume that, yes, we want to have immigrants in our country, yes, they benefit our country, and we want to include them in our society, how do we fix it? Well, it's an election year and everybody has ideas about how to fix it, and that's not our conversation here today. But the goal is to find a way to update the law so that whether it's a situation where we have to find a way to create a path to a legal status for the 11 million people who are here in undocumented status, and whether we need to, and what we need to do to find a way to keep immigration attorneys from telling mothers, look, your child's not going to come for another 8 years. Yes, you're going to miss the birthday parties and your grandchildren and that's going to happen. And no, she's not going to get a visa, a tourist visa to come and visit. If you can't go there, you can't see them. So that's the legal challenge that we have to overcome for immigration inclusion to happen. And I believe it's the pathway for the next step for social inclusion. One of the things I wanted to ask about today is back to the scenarios I was talking about. In the first scenario for Rosalinda, does anybody feel that, or how do you all feel about Rosalinda being able to come forward as a victim of a crime, and it's a personal crime to her, even though she's undocumented and the state's using their resources to protect her, and she eventually will be allowed to remain in the United States to go forward with the crime, go forward with the prosecution. Is that something that we should be focusing our limited resources and, or is there an opinion that if she's just not here, those things won't happen to her? Yes.
My response to that would be that regardless of where you're from, we're all human and we all should be treated with dignity and respect. So, even though she's probably here illegally, I don't think she should be treated any differently from me or you that's born. Well, I'm not sure if you're born here, but I'm born here. And so I think that, if something were to happen to her, despite she's illegal and stuff, they can deal with that probably after, but at least, making sure that whoever, the hurt her or what she, how she's being treated, they get their right punishment.
Okay. Anybody else? And I'm sorry if I don't see. Are you raising your hand? One person to, now I'm going to give you, you say two separate things. What do you mean?
Sure. You're talking in immigration. You're talking also a criminal act that was against her. So I don't think one should go with the other. If she reports it, immigration isn't going to come and run her off. I'd have to ask a police officer, but... if you're reporting a crime against you, I don't think that has nothing to do with immigration. Or it shouldn't.
It shouldn't. I like that. It shouldn't. And that's one of the things that we want to emphasize. It shouldn't. But that's, I'm sorry.
You have to give your identification to file a report. So anyone that makes a complaint is going to be registered in that complaint. If you're undocumented, you're going to be vulnerable.
They don't work that fast. Immigration, I know because I've worked with a lot of immigrants. It doesn't work that fast.
Well, I guess the...
I think the gentleman just put the fear in her because she doesn't know any better.
And I think that's the important part. In some places they do. There's places in Arizona where they probably work fast. They may not work that fast here, but...
That's all they have to do. Yeah. You live in a little town, and that's all they have to do. Go move to a big town.
And that's the concern. And you were saying... And the truth of the matter is, it really depends, and how that situation is resolved depends on what the norms are and what our society says we want to happen. If we had a sheriff that really wanted to push for finding people who are undocumented and getting them out of the community, and we elect that sheriff and we endorse his views, then that will be the way the immigrant community views how our society sees them. And if they believe that our society is, they're going to be hunted, then they're going to always be in a situation where they're going to seclude themselves and stay in the shadows.
Or leave Dodge,
if they have the resources. If they have the resources. Yes. So I think that in that situation, that it kind of, I used a criminal justice background because, well, one, I was a former prosecutor, but also it is the situation that makes us think, you know, so after all of this is taken care of and after the person is prosecuted, should Rosalinda now feel like I've given my information, I've given my identification, my location, I'm going to be removed very soon from this country? If that's what she believes will happen, then she's not going to report. And then what makes it worse is she's also not going to report the situation where she witnessed the abuse for the child, because she has her own children and she can't risk them being sent back to where she came from. And the worst case scenario is if we have a society that promotes an atmosphere that's so repelling to immigrants and non-citizens that they feel like if they're an individual in a situation of Khalil, they're not going to report. They don't want to be associated with that and they're just going to stay away. And in my mind, that's the worst case scenario. I'm sorry?
I was wondering, I was like, does he see me? My question is that, and I respect the woman's opinion, but it further goes to how we don't know the half of it and how hard it is for illegal immigrants. She just said, well, why don't you just move to a bigger town? Like, it's so easy. And just being with a person who my family background and the people in our community, a lot of people without papers and their lifestyle, how they're migrant workers and have to go work out in the field. And you're talking about very low wage jobs. It's not that easy. So do we want to be a society where we're like, well, the United States is big enough, just move somewhere else? Or do we want to just treat people with dignity and humanity? Yes, immigration is a legal issue. However, I don't think we should have the attitude where just because it isn't happening to us personally or maybe our someone that we love very much, that we should assign an arbitrary solution to it, because these people are living very complicated lives, oftentimes in poverty, in undercover. And, you know, I mean, there was a lady that people with papers would just say, well, they hear that Obama is rounding up all the illegal immigrants, and she spent months sleeping under her bed. I mean, and this is somebody that's a cleaning lady, doesn't make much money, but is supporting two families back in her home country. So I think if we think about people as human beings and dignity and how we wanted to be treated, regardless of how they got here, I think we would be more accepting in this society.
I think it would be easy to agree here that the laws from 1952 are probably not applicable to today's society. But realistically, as a prosecutor, someone in the law, how long does it take to change law?
Is there another question? We'll take a couple questions. All right, what we'll do is we'll take two or three questions. We'll have a couple rounds of questioning. We'll take two or three questions. So that's the first question.
So I have a question that kind of leads with that, and I don't know how deep this question can get. The law that we know is wet foot, dry foot. I wanted to get some more clarity on that, and so that leans back to 1952 or wherever that started. So,
And then one other question from this side. Miss.
I'm just bringing up the difference between someone who is in this country with a green card or comes in as a student, a foreign student, and then doesn't leave. So that brings up a whole other group of people in a very different situation than you described. And I know as an educator from Connecticut, we had a number of people coming in to teach language from Spain and Mexico and so on, China. And we had a lot of issues with anchor babies. So there's that whole other piece that we haven't even talked about this morning. I know there's so much to discuss, but that's another facet that we could consider as well.
The first question was, how long does it take to change the law? Well, that it's voting season, and we've been promised that the law is going to change and immigration reform is going to happen. And there are a lot of different ideas of what that's supposed to look like. But the fact of the matter is, it's been nearly a decade, more than a decade, since we've been promised the law is going to change. And it hasn't changed. There's been little amendments. There's been Band-Aids. We're going to do an amnesty, or we're going to do a deferred action, or we're going to do a secure communities project. But what hasn't happened is an overall review and change of the immigration law. I don't know when that will happen. Hopefully when the executive branch and the legislative branch can see eye to eye long enough to get a bill passed, and that'll be good for our country. The second question was the wet foot, dry foot question. Wet foot, dry foot is a form of amnesty. I'm sorry, a form of asylum. I'm very sorry. It's a form of asylum. When the Cuban national, we had a negative relation with the Cuban government, Fidel Castro, Cuban Missile Crisis, so forth. And a lot of refugees from Cuba came to the United States. And the goal of that law was to allow individuals who actually came to the United States and landed to have some protection from being sent back to Cuba. The belief is, in many situations where asylum is granted, individuals who come to the United States seeking asylum for political reasons or other reasons, if they're sent back, they're going to suffer some form of persecution or torture, may even be killed. So the goal of that law was to allow an individual to, when they get here, to stay here. And the last question.
The last question dealt with the implications of people who overstay.
Okay. So we were talking about the difference between the green card and individuals who, and ma'am, I'm gonna let you readdress it again because I don't wanna mess it up.
People who come here on a green card, if you could explain to us how that benefits them, but they're still not legal residents of the United States, or students who may come to go to school here and then don't go home with the date, you know, stamped on their student visas. And then that whole issue of anchor babies, if they have children here, and then does that help them then gain residency?
So the first one, I'm gonna go backwards so I don't forget. The first issue related to anchor babies. That term is one of the arguments, most significant misnomers. If someone comes to the United States and has a US citizen baby, that baby cannot petition for their parent until that child is 21 years old. So that's not much of an anchor. And if the person came in unlawfully, the petition could be approved, but a visa and a residence card would not be issued unless there was some waiver or the parent returned to their home country and came back through the U.S. Embassy. So when people mention anchor babies and that phenomena, I like to clear that up. It's having a U.S. citizen child here who's 5, 6, 7, 8 doesn't anchor you to the United States. They have no ability to keep you here. The green card and the student visa. A student visa is a temporary non-immigrant status that's granted for what's called a duration of status. So as long as you're a student, you should be able to maintain that status. But there are things that will move you out of that status if you work without authorization. So that's, in our example, Khalil was working without authorization. So he was going to lose his student status, but oftentimes, one runs out of resources. When one has a green card, that's the lawful permanent residency I'm talking about. That means you are here in a lawful status. You can work, you can travel in and out of the country, you can petition for your spouse, you can petition for your children. You are here lawfully, and in at most five years, you are now eligible to apply for citizenship. So for most immigrants and non-citizens, the green card is that's the goal, that's the holy grail. That means you can stay. The government has said, unless you do something bad, we're going to let you stay.
We'll go to that side of the room. We only have 10 more minutes, so we'll get 3 questions from this side of the room, and then there'll be some closing statements.
Hi, Mike. It's not a question, it's more like a statement, because I'm not a U.S.-born person. I was born in Colombia, and I was brought here when I was 2. And my parents also came here trying to look for a way out of the country because my country was doing really bad at that state. So I've related to almost every different scenario you've said, and it's a little bit hard when you hear people say, get up and just move, because there's situations where you can't leave because you're facing not just your boss, but somebody that has more money than you, has more resources than you, and they can take you down easily and say that what you're saying isn't true. And nobody's going to believe you as the immigrant, as a lower person. They're not going to treat you as well. So there's a lot of people here that they don't have the courage to stand up and say, I was being abused by my boss. My boss was physically treating me bad. They don't have that courage because their boss could be a very well-known person, and they're going to believe their boss over that immigrant. So that immigrant has everything to lose. They have their being able to stay here. They have to provide for their family. So they're not going to risk it all for it, and they're going to just stay quiet and take the abuse. So it's a scenario where you have to go through a lot. And immigrants, they go through a lot, and they don't have it easy. And there's situations where there's immigrants that abuse it, and there's immigrants that really, they're just trying their best to fight for the opportunity to stay here. I've been fighting my whole life to stay here because I've been put on trial to be deported many times. And I'm only 18, and in 18 years, I've fought for my right to be here all my life. And it's just me and my mom now because everybody else was deported. So it's situations where you have to think about many different people that are going through this, and it's not easy at all.
Are there any questions on this side? Yes, miss.
I'm not sure I have a question other than maybe a statement. I'm glad I'm in here because I'm one of the ones who said, why can't immigrants just do it the right way? Didn't realize the process was so complicated. But one of the things I heard, I'm not sure it's true, and maybe you can tell me, because from what I understood, that even though you have people who are here illegally, they somehow can still access services in this country. So if that's true, then they're still getting some benefits to being here, but I'm seeing you shaking your head no, that's not true.
Okay. And then one other question from this side. Are there any other questions from this side? One last question. Okay. We'll answer these two thoughts. You said you had a question? Statement, okay.
Before I say what I want to say, I just want to, so I don't want anybody to think that what I'm going to say is biased. I'm born here in America, but both my parents are from Haiti and everything. And I don't consider myself Haitian American or American. I say I'm Haitian and everything. And even though I'm born here, my mother raised me the way that other kids would be raised in Haiti. So with that being said, and being an adult right now and everything, yes, it's hard for immigrants. I've seen it on both ends. But at the same time, when you hear some of the other prejudice or what other people are saying about immigrants need to go back to their country and everything and stuff, America is a country of opportunities and everything. And a lot of stuff, and a lot of stuff that, you know, we receive out here, for example, and I'm going to use only Haiti for an example because that's where my family comes from. A lot of stuff, the opportunities that we have over here, you don't have that in Haiti. So in a way, Americans should be able to protect their country and everything. So not all immigrants coming now, not all of them are here for a good purpose. Some of them, they come here to destroy. Some here come to jealousy. And we've seen that happen. So we have to look on both sides of the spectrum and everything and stuff, you know. With the relating to jobs and everything, you know, I heard somebody say something that's the truth. You know, what job did you come most Haitians and Hispanics are doing? You know, they're doing jobs that we say that we don't want to do and everything. You can't get jealous. You can't say that they're taking up your jobs, but they're doing the stuff that you said you would never do and everything, only because they want to send and help their families and everything. But at the same time, too, when they're breaking their backs and I see those kids coming over, they're bringing their kids here, they're imitating what they're seeing Americans do, not just Americans, but other people doing TV, killing each other and everything, that's not right too. And they deserve to get kicked out. So it's on both sides of the spectrum.
Thank you.
Well, I want to thank you for sharing your story and you for sharing your comments. And what I wanted to mention is, I wanted to speak to the immigrants getting benefits. The law does not provide for immigrants, for individuals who are in undocumented status to receive need-based benefits. However, their children, if their children are U.S. citizens, their children can receive benefits. The government has not come to the point yet where it says, if you happen to be born from an undocumented person and you need benefits, we'll not provide those benefits for you. So there's a little bit of confusion because you'll see people who are undocumented and they will be able to have food stamps, but that food, those food stamps or the WIC or whatever is being provided for the benefit of the U.S. citizen child that they're raising. Well, I guess my time is running out, so I have to wrap up, but I've really enjoyed having the opportunity to talk with you about this issue that is, you know, extremely timely, extremely important. It's personal to me as I'm the son of an immigrant as well, and not born in this country. However, I wanted to remind you all to please think about the immigration matter and think about how we are going to include immigrants into the United States. I want to leave you with the fact that I believe they do make our country better, and although our immigration laws do need some updating, there certainly are some opportunities for immigrants to come forward and try to get that legal status that will hopefully propel them into becoming more integrated into our society. When I say that, I always feel like I have to give this warning as well. There's a lot of people, like the young lady mentioned, and I believe it was you as well, that are here willing to exploit the immigrants and non-citizens, and they claim to provide legal services or tax services, and all they do is get them in trouble. If you know anyone who needs help with immigration, make sure they work with a licensed professional, a CPA or an attorney or somebody who can make sure that they can help them without hurting them. My name is Chris Gaston. I appreciate your time this afternoon.